God has a purpose for you to be here today. Everything, every good thing that we do, sometimes we think that, oh, I've done this good thing. But actually, we have been led by the Spirit to do so. Amen?
Amen?
Amen? So you have been led. It's good to tell yourself, oh, good job, I came to church today. By the end of the day, God is the one who brought us here. And when God brings us here, He brings us here for a reason. Wherever God brings you, if you go to a place that's not led by God, then you cannot say there's something good. But if you come to a place that's led by God, then definitely there's something good. Tell your friend, something good awaits you. Come on, tell your friend.
Something
good awaits you. Okay? I was telling Thomas yesterday, I was speaking to him. He has so many questions for me. He like, you know, put me in the spot, which is really good, you know, to have people throw questions at you. You know, so he says, I was teaching Thomas yesterday, I said, and many of you who heard me preach, you know this. There's only one currency in the kingdom of God. What's that currency?
Faith.
Everyone say faith.
Faith.
I was telling Thomas, I was in England, I was recently in London, and I had to use pounds. Without pounds, I cannot buy anything. If I gave them ringgit, I will get scolding. I had to use pounds. The kingdom of God, faith. So you can sit in God's presence with being faithless. You get nothing. Are you listening? You can have the best preacher, you can have the grammar word. Grammar word means a special word that God gives you. But you have no faith. You get nothing. You can have the best person who have the gift of healing pray for you. But you have no faith. You get nothing. So you have a role to play. Without pounds, you get nothing in London. Without faith, you get nothing in the kingdom of God. So don't sit in a place, don't turn the Bible on your own, being faithless and then having... Are you sure this is God's word? God says, have faith like little children. Say amen.
Amen.
And tell that to yourself. And I need to tell that to myself. When God says that He will bless me, I have faith He will bless me. When God told me 20 years ago, He will send me to the ends of the earth. And I believed it at that time, 20 years ago. Today I've been to nearly 30 countries already. That's not the whole world, but that's a lot of countries. But 20 years ago, He told me I'm going to many parts of the world. I couldn't understand how it's going to happen. But God prophesied. Three different prophets spoke into my life. You will be sent to the ends of the earth to preach the good news. And today I've been to nearly 30 countries. And all glory to God. And God's word came to my life, but I didn't reject it. The moment you are faithless, you reject the hands of God. Are you listening? And God is super active. He's ready to do things for us. The question is, do we want God to do it for us? You don't need to do anything. You just have to have faith. And Jesus said with His own lips, with faith even mountains will be moved. And he used an exaggerated illustration. Mountain, you know, cannot be moved. But Jesus says, with faith, even mountains can be moved. It means the most impossible thing can be done if you have faith. Amen.
Amen.
So never forget, it's never about whether God can do it or not. God definitely can do it. The question is, do you want God to do it or not? And your role is to have faith. So tell your friend beside you, let's have faith today. Come on.
Let's have faith today.
Hallelujah. Let's turn to the book of Luke at chapter 18. And I'll just tell you, one of the best ways to have faith is to continue to listen to God's word. The Bible says this, for those who have never heard this before, please listen. For those who have heard, hear again. Faith comes from hearing and hearing of the word of God. Lift your hands up if you have heard that verse before. Come on. Okay, that's in the Bible. So if you wonder, I don't have faith, fine, God has the answer. I don't have faith. Doesn't matter, God has the answer. Play your role. God says faith comes from hearing and of hearing. So twice, hearing and of hearing the word of God. That's not part of my sermon, I just wanted to share with you. So even as you sit in this sanctuary today, don't be distracted by the baby's cry, because you can still have faith in the midst of a baby's cry. You can say amen.
Amen.
Nothing to distract you. There's no excuse. I can't hear the baby's cry. I can't have faith. Pastor is too handsome. No, you can have faith. You can have faith. Just make a choice to have faith. Just believe. You can say amen.
Amen.
So as I preach God's word today, you just believe. Believe, don't believe me. Believe the word of God. My words can do nothing for you, but God's words can do everything for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So Luke chapter 18 verse 38, the word of God says this. He called out, somebody calling out to Jesus, and 17 times, everybody say 17 times.
17 times.
17 was called with this phrase. What phrase is that? Son of David. 17 times in the New Testament, Jesus was called Son of David. Son of David. Not Son of Solomon. Not Son of Joseph. But Son of David. 17 times. And this David here speaks about King David. King David in the Old Testament. All of you know there's many kings, right? Yeah. There's many amazing kings. Okay, one of the most amazing kings that lived in the Old Testament was King Solomon. Okay, and he is the son of King David. But Jesus was never known as Son of Solomon. But he was known as Son of David. 17 times. Don't ask me why 17 times. I was also asking God this morning. Maybe there's a reason why 17 times. But I know, and I know that Jesus was known as Son of David. And he was known as Son of David was because, do you know that Mother Mary and Joseph, they are both descendants of King David. Do you know that? How many of you know that actually? Okay, it's not that actually you know. And that's the reason why Joseph and Mary had to go to Bethlehem. They had to go to Bethlehem because it was told that you have to go to where your ancestors come from to be registered at that time. So it was deliberate. The Father in heaven deliberately, because Mother Mary and Joseph, they are special people. Not anybody, any Tom, Dick and Harry can become the father of Jesus. Not any woman can be the mother of Christ. Are you listening? They have to be to fulfill prophecy. Everybody say prophecy.
Prophecy.
It was prophesied that special Jesus comes from the line of David. Amen. Cannot be anybody, any, you can be the best woman on earth, you cannot become the mother of Jesus. You have to be from the line of David. So when Jesus is known, when Jesus is called Son of David, it is meant that he is physically, his physical genealogy is of David's line. That his great, 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 great grandfather, both father and mother, both Joseph and don't underestimate, say, oh, Joseph was just his adopted father. How many of you know that we become children, adopted children of God through adoption? Amen. Amen.
Amen.
We are not biologically children of God. We are adopted sons and daughters of God. And even as adopted sons and daughters of God, we get the full blessings of the children of God.
Amen.
And if you study the Jewish culture, you will see that adopted children, once you're adopted, means you are forever adopted. Listen, this is in the Jewish culture, for those who don't know. Adopted child, once they are adopted, they are forever a child. But a biological child, if the father disowned, they can be disowned. Are you getting it? That means a adopted child can never be disowned. But a biological child can be disowned by the parents. Get it? So if you ask me who holds a better place, once a parent in the Jewish culture adopt a child, means you are forever my child. But as your biological child, if I disown you, means you're no longer my child. But no way can adopted parents disown an adopted child. Get it? So for those who feel, for those of you who are adopted child, and for those of you who feel that, oh, I'm just an adopted child of Father God, you got it wrong. Okay? Don't, some of you are falling asleep, don't fall asleep.
No.
The devil wants you to fall asleep. This is God's word being preached to you. Open your eyes, wake up, and receive. Because faith comes from hearing the word of God. You can say amen.
Amen.
And when you sleep, you can't hear. Then faith will not come. So if the devil is singing lullaby, you're just letting you shut up in Jesus' name. I want to hear God's word. Let's turn to Acts chapter 13, please. Thank you, Lord. Speak to us, Lord. Your servants are listening. Acts chapter 13, verse 22, if you are there. And the word of God says this. After removing Saul, Saul is King Saul, the king that was chosen by the people before King David. All these are interesting, this is history. Saul was the people's choice. God was their king, but they were not satisfied, the people of Israel, those days. They look at other nations, they had a king. We want a king too. Even though God was their king, but they were not satisfied. They said, I want a king. We want a king, the Israelites said. They chose Saul. But it was not God's choice. Are you listening? So after Saul, but when it comes to God's choice, God chose David, King David. So let's read this. After removing Saul, why was Saul removed? Because he was a wicked king. A Okay, he went against God. So he was removed. You can never be part of God's plan if you continue to carry on in your wicked ways without repentance. Repentance is part of God's plan. And who can say amen?
Amen.
Okay, it's part of God's plan. Don't take sin so lightly. Your grace, God loves me no matter what. Yes, God loves me no matter what. But if you continue to do the things that God doesn't want to do, it's very difficult for you to accomplish the things that God wants to accomplish for you in your life. For example, if you are a drunkard, you are a drunkard and God is telling you, quit being a drunkard. Over and over again, God's revealing to you, stop getting drunk, stop getting drunk. So no, God loves me no matter what. True, amen. No matter how many times you get drunk, God still loves you, you can say amen. But God can never use you. Are you listening? God loving you and God using you are two different stories. You can have sex with hundreds of people and God will still not stop loving you. Who can say amen?
Amen.
But God comes to me and says, stop doing that. Stop doing that. No, you still love me. Yes, I still love you no matter what. But I cannot use you. Christianity is not just about being loved by God, but it's also about being used by God. And who can say amen?
Amen.
And that is why the Holy Spirit dwells inside of us. To lead us daily, to make us better people. Not just to enjoy God's love, yes, that's priority, but to also be used by God. And that is why we are on planet Earth. That's why we are not in heaven. Though we are saved, but we are still on this earth. I keep on saying this over and over and over again these last days. Because we are to be used by God. Amen.
Amen.
So let's look at King Saul. He wanted his own way. Okay, he was filled with jealousy. He planned murder. All kinds of things he did. He was the king. And he refused to repent. That's King Saul. He was blessed to be a king. But he refused. He wants his own way. Just the same as us. Many of us are blessed. None of us can say I'm not blessed. We are all blessed in different ways. But you continue to disobey God, God will have to remove that blessing from your life. Not because God doesn't love you. God loves you. But God just has to be God. Being mean, God equals to being in charge. Who can say amen? That's why we call him God. We don't call him dog. We call him God. Dogs are there, God are there. Amen. Sometimes we call God God, but we treat him like somebody else. Like something else. Like Santa Claus. Do what I say, like my mate. Do what I do. Do what I want you to do. No, no. God, we call him God, meaning we are saying you are in charge. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. So after removing Saul, he made David their king. God made David their king. The next guy. God testified concerning him. Don't forget, this is in the New Testament, Acts chapter 13. So see, David is remembered right from the, in the New Testament, all over the New Testament. So is Saul. And so is Saul for his ugliness. And David is remembered for the beautiful thing in his life. God testified concerning him. I have found David, son of Jesse. Jesse is David's father. And the next phrase is so powerful. Why? Why God chose David? Not because David was perfect. For those who do not know David committed murder. David committed adultery, for those who do not know. But yet, David, in the eyes of God, David was special. David was super special. Are you listening? So if you think that you're a sinner and you can never be super special, you got it wrong. To be super special in God's eyes is not based on the sins that you have done. It's based on what's inside here, your heart. The place where nobody can see, but God can. Amen.
Amen.
So you may be the biggest prostitute in the past. Okay? But you can end up being someone whose God's eyes is on you. Compared to someone who has not done many sins, but the heart is where God sees and God doesn't admire. Okay, look at David. Why is David super special? Why? The last phrase of Acts 30:22. A man after my own heart. That means David lived his life for the pleasure of God's heart. He lived his life to make God happy. He is lousy in the life. In many aspects, lousy. He committed that. He looked at another man's wife on the balcony, and he was excited, and he wanted to have her for himself. He wanted to have sex with somebody's wife, and because he had the authority, he planned in such a way where the woman's husband get murdered, his plan, and his kingdom, and then he can get the wife. they had sex with her, and she became pregnant. Are you listening? And then we found out the husband died, he married the woman. Everything was planned by King David. This guy that God calls after, a man after God's heart. Are you listening? So God's judgment, the way God judges human is not the same way we judge human. We judge people according to what they have done. Oh, that guy, he's the worst guy yet. He had that three wives before. He did this, he did that, he cheated people. No, God doesn't judge that. God judges the heart. And I'm glad God judges the heart because no one else can see it but Him. Amen. Amen. We can put our makeup, we can try to look like such a pleasant looking person. But you can do all you want from the outside and go for hundreds of blood surgery, it doesn't impress God. God looks at your heart.
Amen.
Are you following? Look at that. If you don't believe me, then look there. Look at this. The king, the one, a man after my own heart. I called it the guy with the heart of gold. This is the real definition, the heart of gold. David had a heart of gold. Everyone say heart of gold.
Heart of gold.
When we say heart of gold, we all say, oh, very kind. But I believe the heart of gold is the heart after God's heart. But what does that mean? The next phrase explains, He will do everything I want Him to do. Though He may fall into sin, but whenever God says do, He do. You can say amen. That's the definition of a man after God's heart. God says give, He give. God says forgive, He forgive. God says go, He go. God says come, He come. God says stop, He stops. God says serve, He serves. God says sell the FD ticket, He sell the FD ticket. Seriously, let's get real. God says clean the church for free, give the allowance in the offering. He will clean the church for free and give the allowance in the offering. And I'm not manipulating here, I'm telling you the truth. That's the definition of a man after God's heart. A man after God's heart is not just to give your hands on Sunday and worship and sing good songs. God doesn't want us to just worship, God wants to do many things on this planet. Who can say amen? God says forgive, you forgive. God says go on a fast, you go on a fast. God says wake up 5 o'clock every morning to pray, to be with me. You wake up every 5 o'clock in the morning and pray with me. Whatever God says, and you study the life of David, David was like that. David truly was a man after God's heart. So there is hope in all of us sinners. Those of us who commit adultery. Those of you who have committed homosexual sins. Those of you who are gossipers and liars and slanderers. Today make a decision to have a heart of gold. A heart that goes after the heart of God. Be ever ready. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. And then obey. Don't doubt. And God says, I believe and do it. Real believing always comes with action. You can say amen.
Amen.
If God says, forgive Ruby. Let's say, I say, yeah, I believe I must forgive Ruby. But I see her, that's not forgiving. Seriously, if God says, forgive Ruby, she has done so much bad in my life. I say, okay, I believe I should forgive her. I'll run away from her. Forgiveness. Everything that happens in your heart will be manifested in your action. Mm-hmm. You can say amen.
Amen.
And those are real things. Things that come out of your life, if it's real, it comes from your heart. Not just that, I forgive Ruby, you know, I forgive Ruby, you know. But your heart, you cannot see the sight of face. That you have not forgiven her. I mean, Ruby is just an example, like, you know, I'm just saying. Whatever God calls you to believe and do, it will come out from your heart and the results will be amazing. Say amen.
Amen.
So no king of the Old Testament was like King David in God's standard. In people's standard, if you study the Bible, what kind of person God says the best person? And he was known as Jesus, you know. The pure Jesus is known as the son of David. Why? Your father called me adultery. But God doesn't care. God's standard is different. God chose David because in God's eyes, David was the best. Say amen.
Amen.
Why? Because he had the heart of the God's heart. Period. And all of us, we are alive. We can be like that in the standard of God. And starting today, the moment God says, you obey. We do everything that God says to do. And look at David. Do you know that his son was wiser than him? Who was his son? King Solomon? King Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived. He was a king. Not just wise, the richest man. But he, in God's eyes, David was greater than Solomon. That's why Jesus was known as the son of David. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Let's desire them. So to desire them, and I tell you, this world will be a better place to live in. Our church will be a better place to come. Our homes will be a better place to live in. Our workplace will change when we have the heart of David. Because God will always call us to do good things and godly things. You can say amen.
Amen.
Just imagine all of us at David's heart. All of us, though we are sinners, but we have the heart to always obey God and David. Wow, what a word! By now, I think everybody, the 7 billion people, get born again already. But it's never, it's not happening. Because very few Christians have the heart of David. Very few! And that is why this message is being presented to us today. For us to say, oh, I want to have a new heart. A heart of gold, a heart like David. I want God to call me a woman after God's heart, a man after God's heart. A heart that does everything that God says. Hallelujah. Let's turn to 2 Samuel. Let's go to the story of David now. 2 Samuel chapter 12 and verse 13. This is the, to cut the story short, this is the part when he had sex with Bathsheba. Okay? And then she got pregnant with his child. And God is not pleased with sin. Just because God loves David, God has to still be God. Just imagine, listen, huh? Just because God loves you. Oh, I love Moses so much, he can sin all his want. No matter how much God loves us, God still hates sin. Are you listening? God is not God if he comes to the place and he says, I love Moses so much. I don't care about sin. No. Sin is sin. And there is consequences in sin. Who can say amen?
Amen.
There are consequences in sin. 2 Samuel 12, 13. Then David said to Nathan, Nathan is a man of God. God told Nathan to go and speak to David. David was sinning. He was having sex with somebody's wife. He was sinning. So David said, the Father in heaven asked Nathan to go and counsel David. And David, this is David's response. I have sinned against the Lord. Everyone say, I have. So when God rebukes you or me, we are to say, I have. Instead of, no, I didn't. No, that's not sin. No, you are judging me. We are to say, yes, I have. We have to humble ourselves and admit it. You and I, all of us. Instead of manipulating God's ways. No, Lord, this is not sin. I had to lie. If I don't lie, then blah, blah, blah. I had to do this. I had to do that. A heart of David was a heart that says, yes, I have sinned. Stop justifying ourselves. Even she also did it, but for us, you can do what? Not about her, it's about you. She's accountable to God and you are accountable to God. You're not accountable to each other. So when a rebuke comes into my life or a rebuke comes into your life, we are to say, yes, I have, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Instead of trying to find a way to justify your sin. Yes, he admitted his sin. And he humbled himself then. Today he said, yes, I have sinned against the Lord. And his wife. At the end of the day, every sin is done against the Lord. He sinned against Uriah. Uriah is the husband of Bathsheba. But he actually knows the truth. Every sin that you and I commit, ultimately, whether it's you doing something bad to yourself, you poke needles from your body in drugs, or you have sex with a prostitute. Yeah, you're hurting her when you have sex with a prostitute. You're hurting yourself. But ultimately, every sin that we commit, we're actually hurting God. Are you listening? And this is a revelation we cannot afford not to have. The one who loves us most is being hurt because sin breaks his heart. When we sin, does God love us less? No. When we sin, God is still crazy in love with us. But do we break his heart when we sin? Yes. Everyone say yes.
Yes.
Yes. So do not take sin lightly. As small as a little gossip, As small as looking down at someone, even if you don't say anything but your heart, jijik, that's already sin. And it breaks the heart of God, and God convicts you and say, don't do that. When jealousy grips your heart, when unforgiveness grips your heart, you cannot forgive someone who said something small. 10 years you still remember. That's sin. And it breaks the heart of God. And every sin is done against God. Let's look at that. I love David. And for your information, just personally, David is my favorite guy in the Old Testament. He is my favorite guy. Okay, I love David. I love studying about David. I have sinned against the Lord. Then Nathan replied, the Lord has taken away your sin. See, this is our God. Same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Say amen.
Amen.
So if you have doubts that God cannot forgive your sin, remember this story today. And many other stories. God is able to forgive my sins. And God is able to forgive your sins. Tell your brother or sister, you are forgiven in Jesus' name. Come on. You are forgiven in Jesus' name. Yes. The devil may whisper in your ears, how can God forgive you? How can you say you are forgiven? That is too big to be forgiven. But the Bible says, you can be forgiven. Hallelujah. And then continue, when God forgives what happened, you are not going to die. Tell your friend, you are not going to die. You are not going to die. That's in the Bible, okay? It's in the Bible. Okay, it's in the Bible. Look at that. The Lord has taken away your sin, you are not going to die. In other words, David was concerned, he thought he was going to die. Because David knows the power of God. So he said, I'm so scared I'm going to die. I'm so scared I'm going to die. But then the man of God told him, don't worry, you are not going to die.
Whoa.
Two things that stop people from growing, okay? Listen to this. I mean, there's a lot of things, but two major things that stop people from growing, pride and denial. Everyone say pride and denial.
Pride and denial.
Too proud to admit that you have sinned. Too proud to admit that you are a sinner. Or in denial. No, I'm not a sinner. I'm not bad as Clement. If only you know he's corrupt. He's bad as him. If only you knew what he does in his room privately. I tell you, you'll be shocked. I'm not as bad, I'm so good. That's denial. The Bible says, all have sinned. Amen. All of us have sinned. And all of us equally put Jesus on the cross. Hallelujah. Some people will say, King David committed the worst sins. The worst. But yet God rebuked him through a man of God. But yet he was not in denial. And he was humble. Unless we humble ourselves and quit being denial about the fact that we are sinners, or even whenever we sin, we admit it. You know, we unless we come to that place, we'll never grow in the Lord and to progress in our life's journey. Let's turn to the next verse down, verse 14, from where you were earlier. 2 Samuel 12:14. But because by doing this, you have shown utter contempt. Contempt means disrespect, for those who don't know. Okay, you have shown utter contempt for the Lord. So whenever we sin, we disrespect the Lord. Whenever you go on porn, you disrespect the Lord. Whenever you lie, you disrespect the Lord. Are we following? Let's not take sin lightly. Okay, we need to remember that. The son born to you will die. Verse 15. After Nathan had gone home, the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife had born to David, and he became ill. Okay, the message from these verses I want to bring up would be, though we choose not to be proud and not be in denial of our sin, and God forgives us, there will be consequences in our sins. Say there will be.
There will be.
Some of us, because of our sins, God may have forgiven you. You are not proud. You admit, I am humble, but you end up in jail. Are you listening? Some of us may end up with HIV positive. How can I end up? No. This is the consequence of this. This is not the punishment from God. This is the consequence of your own sin. Are you following? So there is no such thing, oh God forgive me already, I'm not in denial, I'm so humble, I admit, so now there's no one. No, no, there will be earthly consequences. But the good news is, God will go with you as you face the consequences. Are you following? Are you following? God is not going to throw you in jail and you suffer in jail, I'm not going to be with you. For, you know, for someone who humbly says, God, it was my mistake, I deserve to go to jail. God is going to journey with you as you are in jail. But for another person who are not humble enough to say, no, it's not my fault. I shouldn't be in jail. I should be somewhere out there. It's your fault. It's your fault that you go to jail alone without God. God can never work or collaborate, even though God loves you, but God can never work with those who are proud. And this is in the Bible. Who can say amen?
Amen.
Just because God loves everybody, it doesn't mean God will work with everybody. God runs away from those who are proud. Are you following? Are you following?
Yes.
Just the same, I can love all of you, but doesn't mean I'm going to hang out with all of you. I hang out with those I like. Get it? But the fact is, I love everybody. Any of you come to me for help, I will help you. That's just I love you. Any of you come to me for help, and if I can help, I will help. That means I truly love each and every one of you. But that doesn't mean every one of you I will chill with. If I had a choice to chill, I would chill with those I like. If I don't like you, why should I chill with you? Get it? Now, God is saying?
Yes.
So God is saying the same way with God. He loves everybody. He even loves Obama. He loves whoever. Hitler. Whatever. He loves Hitler. I have no doubt about it. But you think God is for Hitler? No. Think God is going to protect Hitler? No way. Hitler condemned God. God cannot, and not because God hates him and God not going to be with him and help him. When the moment we reject God, the moment we are proud, the moment we say, God, I don't need you, God will stand away from you. God wants an invitation. Amen.
Amen.
So other consequences of our sin would be, you can end up in divorce. You can end up in divorce because of your sin. You can end up losing your job. You can end up a bankrupt because of your sin. You can end up hurting the people you love because of your sin. Even though God has forgiven you. Even though you are humble now, even though you don't deny you are wrong, but still, there will be consequences. I call this earthly consequences. Okay? But as I said earlier, but in this consequence of sin, God does not leave you. He does not forsake you. You have to go through a divorce because of your sin. God will walk you through that divorce. Who can say amen?
Amen.
God can turn water into wine.
Amen.
Yeah? But God is not causing the divorce. What's causing the divorce is your sin. What's causing you to be in prison is your sin. You killed that person. So God, I believe in you now, so I shouldn't go in prison. No, no, no. That's the earthly consequences. Okay, so there are such things as that. You can ruin someone's reputation because of your sin. You can ruin your own reputation because of your sin. So there are earthly consequences. So that's why David had to go through what he went through. David's child died. In 7 days, David's child died. Die. Are you listening? And I asked God, why? Why must David's child die? You know, first and foremost, I don't know if we have the right to ask God, but God said, for me, I believe this is the word of God. If David's child didn't die, there will be another Bathsheba. Some people will have to face what they face to learn what they need to learn. Get it?
Okay.
So if David, this is what the Spirit was telling me, if David's child didn't die, though he's repented that moment, but he's still a horny king, there will be another Bathsheba. And because of another Bathsheba, there could be another murder, another Uriah. Get it? So some of us need to be thrown in prison. Some of us need HIV positive. Some of us need to get bankrupt. Some of us need to lose our jobs. Are you following? To learn what we need to learn. To become the person that we need to become. God has a plan for us. You can say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And a lot of things need to happen for us to become that person. God didn't put us on this earth just to be born and get married, have children, grow old. God put us on this earth for a purpose. Everybody say for a purpose.
For a purpose.
And a lot of things we have to become. We have to become the man or the woman that we are to become for that purpose to come to accomplish. Get it? Get it? If David didn't learn his cannot go to the next level. Are you guys following?
Yes.
If David didn't learn his lesson, he will not be able to go to the next level. He's going to get stuck there. So we are not to judge God and say, God, why must his baby die? God knows best. Whatever God does, he does what is best for each and every one of us. Say, God does what is best for you. Tell your friend now. God does what is best for you. Yes. Let's turn to the next verse, verse 16. David pleaded with God for the child. He pleaded, you know. He admitted his sin. He humbled himself. And he turned to God. He pleaded to God. He fasted and spent the nights lying in sackcloth on the ground, meaning he truly repented. Verse 17, the elders of his household stood beside him to get him up from the ground, but he refused, don't touch me. I want to repent. That's what he's doing. And he would not eat any food with them. And he's, listen, so instead of cursing God, like many of us do, instead of doubting God, David ran to God. When David was faced with problems, he ran to God. Amen.
Amen.
David ran to God. How many of us, when we face with the consequences of our sins, we run to God? We commit a sin and now there's a consequences come to our way. Instead of running to God, we run elsewhere. David, this is another example, solid example. David sinned, now he's facing the consequences of his sin. He runs to God. Run to God. It is obvious that David repented and not merely regretted. What's the difference between repent and regret? What's the difference? Listen to this difference. Real repentance is coming before God with a heart that desires to never repeat the sin with the help of the Holy Spirit. Listen, that's real repentance. Regret, on the other hand, is a feeling bad. I'm feeling sorry. It's a feeling, huh? I feel sorry. I feel bad because of the painful consequences on yourself or on others that has come because of your sins. Get it? What's the difference now? I repeat. Please listen. Repentance is coming to God. When in the midst of repentance, God is present. Regret has nothing to do with God. Regret is very selfish. Repentance is I come to God and I'm sorry, Lord. I admit that I've sinned and I need you, Holy Spirit, to help me to do whatever it takes not to sin again in this area. That's repentance. Regret is I feel bad. I'm sorry that I committed a sin. Because why? I'm facing the consequences now. Or somebody else is facing the consequences because of my sin. That is regret. And if you look at David, he did not regret, but he repent. And God is calling us to repent. As the Holy Spirit reveals to us our sins, we are to repent. I know of godly people who before they sleep every night, I do it sometimes, sometimes I forget. Before they sleep, they just say, Holy Spirit, show me where I went wrong today. And then repent. I told that lie. I did not love as much as I should. I was angry. I was selfish. I was proud, whatever it is. So daily, we go in the motions. At night, before you lie, you go to sleep with God. And I don't want to do that. I don't want to have this attitude tomorrow. I slept with someone who's not my wife. Whatever sin that you have committed, repent. David's repentance was not cheap. Hence, he proved to God that he is truly feeling remorse for what he had done through his words and through his action. Can you see that David repented and not regret? Guys, can you see that?
Yes.
David repented. Regrets are cheap words. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Sharon, for doing that to you. That's cheap. I always tell my children, sorry is a cheap word. Don't tell me sorry. Prove to me that you are sorry. Don't tell me you are sorry. Some people can't even say they are sorry when they have done something wrong. That's the worst part. Don't even have regret. At least repentance is better than regret. Some people don't have regret. They're nothing. They do something wrong and they feel nothing about it. That's worse than regret. And I pity such people. And I pray for their souls. Let's turn to the next verse, chapter 12, verse 18. On the seventh day, the child died. Did I read this already? Not yet, right? David's attendants were afraid to tell him that the child was dead, for they thought, while the child was still living, he wouldn't listen to us when we spoke to him. How can we now tell him the child is dead? He may do something desperate. Verse 19, David noticed that his attendants were whispering among themselves, and he realized that his child was dead. Then he asked, is my child dead? Yes, they replied, he is dead. Then, listen to this part, I love this part. David is like an ongoing person. Then, David got up from the ground, after he had washed his face, put lotions on himself, changed his clothes, he went to the house of the Lord and worshipped. And then he went to his own house, and at his request, they served him food, he ate. David started all over again. Everyone say, started all over again. This is the heart of a godly person. So it's time, my child is dead. I trust God. When he allows something to happen, means he knows what is best. That was David's attitude. He got up. You see, he was moaning, oh, I don't fit me. He was wearing sackcloth, meaning he was wearing the ugliest clothes to show that in his heart he's repenting. He didn't want to eat. But now that my son is dead. And everybody was surprised, why is David doing this? He should be crying out, his son is dead. But he's not. He started all over again. And this is the title of my sermon actually. It's not about David. The title of my sermon is Start Over Daily. Everyone say, start over daily. Say again. Start over daily. David started all over as though nothing, as though his son didn't die. He just started. He washed himself up. He put on nice clothing. He started, tell me the food. I want to eat food now. He starts. Some people just can't start over. Some people wake up in the morning and they plan to fail. Some people feel, I can never change. I can never change. But David started all over. I love that. I love that about David. He said, you know, my son is already dead. I trust that God knows what he's doing. We trust God's wisdom above our wisdom. And maybe in David's case, unless he went through what he didn't go through, he might never learn the lesson that he needed to learn. If God is allowing us to go through something in any season of our lives, listen, instead of fighting with God, okay, and we don't understand what he's doing, we have to trust him, and we need to know that he knows best, and allow the Spirit of God and the Word of God to lead us daily. Like David in the season of his repentance, we are to press on in that repentance until the end of that season comes. And then we start all over. So David repented until the end of the repentance season. Don't just say, sorry, I'm done, I'm gone. David repented. In other words, he stopped repenting when he realized his son was dead. God will show you. If you have committed a sin, Lucy, for example, and your heart will fill with remorse, and then God will, Holy Spirit will lead you, will remind you. If you're walking with God, the Holy Spirit will speak with you, and you feel remorse, you repent then. Showing God that you are, teach me, Lord, how to be better. Teach me, and God will show you, it's time. It's time to quit your mourning. It's time to move and start all over again. Next day, start all over again. Let's turn to the next verse. Thank you, Jesus. Next, verse 21. His attendants asked him, why are you acting like this? While the child was alive, you fasted and wept. But now the child is dead, you get up and eat. Verse 22. He answered, while the child was alive, I fasted and wept. I thought, who knows, the Lord may be gracious to me and let the child live. But now that he is dead, why should I go on fasting? Can I bring him back to life? I will go to him. David has had a clear revelation of eternity. Say eternity. He says, I will see him. When I die, I'm going to meet my son in heaven. That's what he's saying. Okay? Can I bring him back again? No. I will go back to him, but he will never return to me. So David is, even though his son Solomon is the wisest king, I think David is also smart. Who can say amen? I don't need somebody to mourn anymore. I'm going to start all over now. I will see my son someday in heaven. I'm going to dance with my son in heaven. But now, I must look nice, I must smell nice, and I must start all over again. You can say amen.
Amen.
So are you starting all over again? We need to start, and every new day is a day to start all over again. David rested in God's promises for eternity, of which every Christian needs to badly do. And at the end of the day, nothing on this earth can be compared to the life that God promises every one of His children, that is eternity with Him in heaven. Let's turn to Lamentation. Second last verse. I know it's time because of the mission trip sharing and all that, but it's okay. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22. Hallelujah. Okay, verse 22, Lamentations 3, the word of God says this: because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for His compassions never fail. Verse 23, they are new every morning. Everyone say every morning.
Every morning.
So every morning you're supposed to start up again. Yes, you have committed adultery yesterday, last month, last year, whatever it is. But every morning start up again. Like David, start, every morning start up again. The fact that you're alive, God is giving you and I another chance to start life all over again. Like today, Sunday, I've got up and said, God, thank you for that chance. I'm starting all over again. I don't dwell on yesterday. I know I did that yesterday. I know I did that last week. I know I did that. Good things, bad things, ugly things, wonderful things. But that's yesterday. I want to start all over again today. People will look at me and remember my yesterday, but who cares? I'm going after God's heart, not their heart. Who can say amen? You want to go after God's heart and start all over again. Let's move to verse 23. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 23. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Verse 24. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for Him. Can you say amen? Wake up in the morning and wait upon the Lord. People remind you of your past. The devil will remind you of your past. What you did yesterday or last week, last year, whatever. 10 years ago, they'll remember you. They'll remind you. 20 years ago, they will remind you. But who? You're going to live your life going after what they think, then you can never move on. Then you can never start your life every day. Fresh. Fresh. Look yourself in the mirror and say, whoa, brand new day, brand new Chrysler. Brand new day, brand new Clement. Brand new day, brand new Gary. Whoa, drive your car. Though it's an old car, but it's a new day.
Yeah.
Amen. Hallelujah. True. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Every morning when we wake up, it's a new day. We begin and we should start life all over again with a humble and repentant heart and a heart that's willing to do everything that Father God wants us to do today. Today. Some people cannot start all over because they think it's useless to do so. So they believe that they will never change. They have given up and they have lost hope. So they wake up each day being prepared to go downhill. Remember last week, someone? They wake up, in the morning. Nothing. There's nothing today. I'm going to go down. I'm not going to succeed. I'm going to sin again. They wake up with that plan. They will never change. We have to be like David. Put oil. Shave. Come on, shave. Put deodorant, whatever it is. Look good. Every day. Start like David. Let's go to our last, second last verse now. Sorry, that was third last, not second last. John chapter 8, verse 43. Okay? 2:45. The word of God says this: why is my language not clear to you? Because you are unable to hear what I say. You belong to your father. So these are the people who refuse to believe in the word of God. Okay? These are verse 44, you belong to your father, the devil. And you want to carry out your father's desire. He was a murderer from the very beginning. Talking about Adam and Eve time. Not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language. That means his mother tongue is lies. The devil is full of lies. The devil will tell you that you can never start over again. The devil will tell you that you're going to hell. The devil will remind you of all your things that you have done. The devil will stop you from becoming a new person today and then tomorrow. Are you listening? And he's a liar. Amen? He's a liar. This is what the Bible says. Don't ever buy that lie that the devil is doing. Some people are too, they have caught up with the you know, the holy world. They forget there's a devil behind them. There is a devil. And he's waiting to bring you down and to put lies in your head. I read that again. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his mother tongue, his native language. For he is a liar and the father of lies. And because I tell you the truth, you do not believe in me. So make a decision. Everything I'm telling you today is from the word of God, and your job is to believe. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Don't believe, then go back when I post my sermon in Facebook and SIMP. Check the Bible verses. They're all from the Bible. I'm not creating up the Bible. They are from your Bible. Start over. Yesterday's guilt is Satan's powerful weapon. I say this again. Yesterday's guilt is Satan's powerful weapon to stop people from starting life all over again. Guilt brings you down. Repentance brings you up. Okay? The devil tell you, Jerry, oh, you did that yesterday. Thank you for reminding me. Father, I'm sorry, Lord. Get it? So the devil tells you, oh, Joseph, you did that last week. Thank you, stupid Satan, for reminding me. But his goal is to make you regret. But you turn that lemon into lemonade. He said, I'm going to repent, Lord. I repent. Now, go ahead, David. Go down on knees. Wear sackcloth. Sackcloth. You know, that one means the humblest. Stay in your room and say, Lord, I repent. When the devil tells you a sin, he wants you to regret. And pity party. No, you repent. Okay? Satan will continuously remind us of our sins, our weakness, our lack, our inabilities, and so on. If we continue to listen to the father of lies, we will never be able to start today anew. Okay? And we'll never be able to be and do everything that God wants us to be and do everything today. Now truly last verse. 1 John chapter 1. Now we'll close down. Okay? 1 John chapter 1 and verse 6. And the word of God says this. If we claim to have fellowship with Him and yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, purifies us from all sin. Everyone say, I'm purified from all sins. Come on. I'm purified from all sins. Everyone say, all sins.
All sins.
Tell your friend, all your sins are purified. Tell your friend, all your sins are purified. In the Bible, okay, it's in the Bible, all, okay, even all the big sin, all, through Jesus, all, so you can start all over again. Verse 8, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Let's pray, let's all rise up and pray. Come on, let's stand up. Father, we thank you. We thank you for reminding us of your love once again. We thank you for reminding us, Lord, truly, every day, we can and we should start over. Every day is a new day, Lord God. Like in David, the season of repentance is done and over. He started all over. And that's the man after your heart, oh God. And I pray for each and every one of us, truly every man and every woman in this sanctuary today, Lord God, that we will be people after your heart, oh God. And Lord God, let us just begin every day anew, afresh, Lord Jesus. Thank you for reminding us that all of our sins are forgiven. Through Jesus Christ, we are purified. Amen. All things are washed by your blood, Jesus. Amen. No guilt be upon our shoulders. No guilt be upon our shoulders, Lord God. For I pray for each one of us, whenever Satan reminds us of our sins, Lord God, instead of being guilty, Lord God, we will repent, humbly repent, and claim the Holy Spirit to give us the strength to press on and to start life all over again. In Jesus' name, we ask and pray, and all God's people say, Amen. Amen. Let's give Jesus a clap offering. Hallelujah.